Sometimes life feels like an uphill battle. Like every step is a slog against the forces of gravity. There's actually this ancient myth in Greek mythology of a tragic hero named Sisyphus who was punished by the gods, and he had to spend all of eternity rolling a boulder up a steep hill, and just before it reached the peak, it would roll back down.
Unlike Sisyphus, your relationship with your rock is not meant to be a burden in hard times, but a refuge.
David's destiny was directly tied to a rock. He literally prayed in the Psalms, "The Lord is my rock." Now, what's interesting is David was actually probably praying literally. We always think of that as a metaphor, but David may have literally been hiding behind a rock because he was being hunted by the most powerful man in the world. So when he prayed, "The Lord is my rock," we're talking about the adrenaline, epinephrine flowing, frantic, frenetic writings of a fugitive, a man on the run, and he says, "The Lord is my rock." The Bible says in the book of Proverbs that the coney is a wise animal because it hides in the cleft of the rock. So when, like the coney, predators are chasing you, Saul is hunting you, Goliath is taunting you, like Sisyphus, the heavens seem to be punishing you, the Lord is your rock. He is your hiding place. He is your fortress and your refuge, and you can hide in him. Religion originally came from the word ligament, which means to hold together. A ligament holds things together, and religion in its purest form, not with the witch hunts and the crusades and the political rallying, but in its purest form, it was meant to hold things together. When we have that kind of pure and undefiled religion, where we take care of orphans and widows, spreading peace to the world and getting peace in the presence of the God of hope, then this will hold our lives together. If you feel like your life is falling apart and you've grown anxious, watch this message entitled Overcoming Anxiety at Harvest Riverside, and we're gonna put your life back together. I'm Ben Courson, and you're watching Hope Generation.
If you don't know where I'm from a place called Applegate, Oregon. Now, Applegate, Oregon is population 2, like there's nobody there. In fact, to get out to the church that I speak at, you have to drive past cows and everything. And when people come to church and they see all these people, because it's like a mega church, they see all these people, they're like, where did they come from? Are they hobbits splurting out of holes? Like, where did they come from? And here's kind of the story. So my dad, John Courson, he started the church in the 1970s, in 1977. Now, in 1977, he looked exactly like a hippie. And so he had really long hair, a really massive beard. He resembled Chuck Norris, and he looked like a bodybuilder. And so he came as a hippie to Southern Oregon and started preaching to all these hippies. Well, the hippies at the time were living in treehouses, and so he was like preaching the gospel to them in their treehouses. And these hippies were doing drugs in the treehouses, so they were high in the treehouses, high up in more ways than one. And my dad told them to repent of their drugs. And so they read this story from the book of Acts where Paul confronted a bunch of people who were practicing witchcraft, and they took their witchcraft scrolls and books and they burned them in a fire. So my dad's like, we need to be like the people Paul preached to, and we need to repent. Like, you guys need to repent of all this sorcery, all these drugs that are putting your mind in illusory places like witchcraft. We need to be like the book of Acts and repent of this stuff. So they took the story literally. In the story of Acts, they burned the witchcraft books. So he's like, we need to repent of this. So the hippies repent of their drugs, and they copy the book of Acts, and just like in Acts, they burned their books. So to these hippies, they burned their drugs in a big bonfire, and it didn't necessarily have the effect they were hoping for. They were high on the Holy Ghost in more ways than one. Ain't no high like the Most High. So then my dad's like, I don't know if you guys are tracking with me, but then my dad's like, you guys need to get baptized. Like, baptize right now repent, turn to God and get baptized. So he goes down into the river like and waits for them to come. And by the time he turns around in this freezing river, all these hippies are lined up naked because that's their culture. They think if you go in the river, you go naked. We're hippies. So he sees all these naked hippies and he starts baptizing them. This was in 1977. So he started baptizing all these naked hippies who just burned their drugs. They got born again. And 40 years later, here we are. So that's the church I come from. That's kind of the history. But what God's done through my dad is just amazing. The whole revolution happened. I just finished Greg's book, Jesus Revolution, a few months ago. Such an amazing book. It was something similar that happened in Southern Oregon with my dad. And so I live in Southern Oregon. I get to just come and share around the nation. Also be going on TBN if you guys want to go to the TBN studios next month. There'll be a nationally televised interview if you want to go to that, which could be cool. But I'm excited to share with you. I have a message really on my heart. So would you turn with me first to Proverbs 12? And then after that, we're going to go to Philippians 4. So first, let's go to Proverbs 12. And then we'll go to Philippians 4. My friend, it's funny, you guys had Levi Lesko up here a second ago. His brother Jesse just texted me a few weeks back after I came here. He texted me a study done by CNN. CNN reported that since the year 1999, the suicide rate, watch this, the suicide rate since 99 has increased by 33%. Now, if you don't understand the magnitude and gravity of that statistic, I don't think you understand what's being said here. 20 years ago, in the last 20 years, the suicide rate has increased by 33%. That means compared to 1999, an extra one out of every three people is killing themselves. And you know what's even more wild? A study was done that showed that if you live in this generation in America, even if you live in a trailer park, let's say you have downward mobility, you in the socioeconomic environment are in the lowest rung of the ladder. Even if you live in a trailer park, you have better creature comforts than medieval kings. So you literally live better than kings used to live. But as Viktor Frankl, the logotherapist, said, we have means but no meaning. We have enough to live by, but not enough to live for. We need to encourage our generation that as long as we have a pulse, we still have a purpose. And this is not just for the youth. This is for those of you who are old as well. The Bible in the book of Proverbs says, a gray head is a crown of glory when it's gained in the way of justice. So like Caleb, who at 85 years old said, I'm as strong today as I was 40 years ago when he fought Anakim giants rather than retiring on the beachside condo of Galilee, he took on Anakim giants like Yoda in Attack of the Clones, like fighting Dooku at 900 years old. So too, I don't care what age you are, stage of life you might be in, even if you have a crown of glory, white hairs on your head, there might be snow on the rooftop, but there can be fire in the furnace. Come on. I don't care what age you are, stage of life you're in, God has called us to plumb the deeps of hope, to overcome our anxiety, to vanquish our worry, to conquer our fears. He has called us to be bold. He has called us to be brave. He has called us to be enthusiastic. I've never met someone and like, man, I wish they were a little less joyful. I've never met someone and said, they're just way too encouraging. I've never met someone and said, they just have too much hope. Even if you have a lot of hope here today, even if you're pretty fearless and bold right now, don't put a glass ceiling on this thing. God wants to give you even more hope, even more joy. Can I get an amen? Big stuff. Now watch this. First, I want to talk to you about the problem. Then I want to talk to you about the solution. So here's the problem. Proverbs 12:25. Anxiety, the author writes. Are you guys there? Proverbs 12:25. How many of you guys are actually using leather and like actual paper? You're turning pages. Oh, wow. There's the holy ones right there. Okay. How many of you are using iPhones or iPads? Lift them up. Okay. We might be in the minority here with the electronics, but I always like to remind people, if we use tablets, we're actually holier because the first written words of God were recorded on a tablet. So Moses, the Ten Commandments, tablets. Okay. Okay, here we go. Anxiety in the heart of man, Proverbs 12:25, causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Anxiety in the heart causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Medical scientists are now telling us that 75 to 95% of the illnesses that plague us today are a direct result of thought life. 75 to 95%. Two of the typical diseases of modern life, the coronary thrombosis and stomach ulcers, are often the result or derivative of stress. Anxiety in the heart causes depression. Now, here's the thing. We're all going to get sick and we're all going to go into the next life at some time. But the reality is sometimes, not always, but sometimes I think we can actually make it harder on ourselves holistically because we're living life with anxiety. Anxiety in the heart causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Anxiety in the heart. How many of you, don't raise your hand, live with anxiety? I tend to be a worrywart by nature. Anxiety tends to infiltrate my mind all too frequently and all too often. Science tells us that we have 30,000 to 50,000 thoughts neurologically every day. So when's the last time you took time to think about what you're thinking about? I always like to say, as I mentioned last time, we got to get rid of stinking thinking, have a checkup from the neck up, have an attitude of gratitude, and be transformed by the renewing of our minds to gird up the loins of our mind. First Peter says that we might rest our hope fully upon the grace. But here's the reality. Science tells us that we have approximately, roughly, even more than 500 intrusive thoughts per 16-hour day, each intrusive thought lasting 14 seconds. So we have roughly at least 500 intrusive thoughts every day that in a 16-hour day that last for 14 seconds. So a lot of times we have these anxious thoughts swirling around in our minds, and this anxiety causes depression. It's interesting, fear is so bad for your health that it actually releases more than 1,400 known physical and chemical reactions in the body and triggers more than 30 different hormones and neurotransmitters. So fear is actually deleterious and injurious to your health. And what I want to say is this: God has called us to a life of wholeness, to hope. God has called us to be a non-anxious presence in the world. Here's where a lot of our anxiety is coming from. This thing. For 10 years, I had a flip phone. I'm just gonna be really honest about it. I like pretty much hate social media now. And I use it every day, but in my team, we post every day, so I don't quite have the answer right now, because that's how we get the message of hope out, but I just don't like the medium. Here's why. Nobody's talked about this, so I'm gonna talk about it. I've never heard anyone talk about this. You know, people used to ask, like, can robots and humans live together peaceably in the future? Little do we know, the robots are winning. We are not living peaceably. Science is now showing that this thing is messing with our brains. Science is now showing that you take out your phone once every 6 minutes, 150 times per day. And what it does is it triggers a dopamine loop in your brain, which is the same thing that drugs induce, which makes you addicted. So you wonder, like, why is my kid always on this thing? Or why does my finger always ghost to Instagram, even when I'm not thinking about it subconsciously? Even when you delete the app, it still ghosts over there. Like, what's happening? Does my finger have a mind of its own? Like, once every 6 minutes, 150 times per day, we use this thing. And it triggers a dopamine loop. Watch this. When you're on social media, it triggers the same dopamine loop in your brain as gambling. It produces the same chemicals that gambling induce. So when you gamble, apparently, I don't think been into a real casino, but when you're doing the slot machines or whatever, you're throwing the dice, you don't know if you're gonna win or lose. That's where the addiction comes from. It's like, am I gonna win or lose? It's the thrill. You're on edge. It's an adrenaline, a epinephrine rush. So too, whenever you hear your phone go, vroom, vroom, you hear it buzz, you get a vibration, you don't know if it's good or bad. Like, it could be a bad text or a good text. Text, likes, and notifications do the same thing in your brain that gambling does. So you don't know, is this a good comment or a bad comment? And you have to look, because it produces the same dopamine loop in your brain triggered by gambling. And what we're now finding is that scientists are saying we gotta try to be on social media only 2 hours a day, which is crazy, because if you're on it more than that, it actually starts to damage your psychological constitution, your cranial package, and your cerebral gray matter, so it's bad for your brain. And we live in a day where, can I just say this? I don't know if I'm gonna get some angry people, but Instagram's not real. It's a lie. Like, it's not real. Even the stuff we post, like when I post stuff, I'm not posting empty seats. Like, I'm not posting the stuff that, like, when I ate a bag of Doritos, like, I'm not posting that. It's not real. And so we live in this crazy generation where we're all comparing fake lives with each other, and I have never talked to anyone. I have yet to talk to somebody who's like, I feel happier after being on Instagram for 1 hour. Never. Never. And yet this thing, I always like to wonder, like, what would I think if I was an alien? If an alien came here, they would think this was our leash. Like, they would think, oh, they have appendages. They have, like, two hands, 2 feet, and this thing. This digital device is our other hand. It's our other appendage. It's like our leash. And it guides us everywhere. We're addicted to it. We're absorbed in it. And I speak as the chief of sinners here. And we wonder why we have anxiety. All the science is showing us. Do you want to know what sociological scientific research and data has now found? As to, everyone always asks me, this is one of the biggest questions I get asked. Why is your generation now on record, millennials, centennials, post-millennials, why is your generation, Gen Y, Gen Z, the most depressed on record in history? Science has now shown it is partially because of social media. And so the other week, I went on a week and a half and I just didn't look at social media. Even for a week and a half, I had our team post and I just didn't look at it, because there comes a time where you say, I need to protect my peace. Everyone say, protect your peace. There just comes, I'm not saying that you shouldn't be using this. I'm literally using it right now. I'm a hypocrite. But what I am saying is this. There comes a moment in your life where you say, I have to protect my peace. And if this thing is causing me more anxiety and worry, maybe I should be a non-anxious presence in the world and live like Jesus, who walked among the lilies and the flowers and said 5 times in Matthew 6, don't worry. If Jesus has to say something 5 times in one chapter, we should probably listen. Don't worry. Lilies, birds, fundamental isness, this, here, now, I am, burning bush, be present, mindful of what's happening in this very instant. Birds, lilies, don't worry. You wanna know the only thing worry changes? Your blood pressure. That's it. So turn with me one more place, Philippians chapter 4. And while you turn there, Dr. Carl Pillemer, who is a professor at Cornell University, he has met with 1,200 senior citizens to discuss the meaning of life. He was shocked to learn that out of these 1,200 senior citizens that this professor of human development at Cornell University, he was shocked to learn that most people near the end of their life had the same regret. They said, I wish I hadn't spent so much of my lifetime worrying. You want to know a word God has never said? Whoops. And yet we live our life as though that's his most frequent word. God's, in 17 of the 22 chapters of Revelation, on roughly 45 occasions, God's sitting on a throne. He's sitting on a throne. He's on the throne. He's not pacing the deck. He's sitting, chill, on the throne. And here I am acting like God's pacing the deck saying, whoops. I live like a practical atheist and I'm worried. It's crazy. When I was in school, I got a 2.0 grade point average. So it was just bad news bears. But what's fascinating is in math, I hated mathematics. In math, when I was in middle school, we had these textbooks that all the odd number answers were in the back of the book. So like my teachers would always get a little confused and they're like, why are you only getting the odd numbers correct and you're not showing your work? And I would just say, you know, if you want to be number one, you have to be odd, because one is an odd number. So I'm just an oddball and an odd man out. I didn't actually say that. I just thought it was clever right now, but apparently not. Okay, but watch. Whenever there were problems I couldn't solve, the answers were in the back of the book. When you encounter problems in life that you can't solve, the answers are in the back of the book. What's in the back of the book? The last book in the good book, Revelation. That's the end of the book. And the book of Revelation ends with 45 occasions of God seated on a throne. What that's saying is the universe is unfolding as it should. God is seated and perched on a throne. I love how Jesus, one scholar was asked, if you could describe Jesus in one word, what would it be? And he said the word relaxed. Relaxed. He knew he was going to get crucified. And yet he was such a non-anxious presence in the world. He's in a storm. What's he doing in the storm while his disciples are panicking? He's just sleeping. Lazarus dies, his friend dies. And what does Jesus do? He doesn't say, hurry, we gotta go over there and try to raise him from the dead while his body's still warm. He waited 4 days. Like, oh, we'll chill out for a little bit, 4 days, and then we'll raise him from the dead. Martha's clanging pots and pans, mad at her sister Mary, because she's like, Mary, why aren't you helping me in the kitchen? We gotta make food for Jesus. And Jesus says, chill out, Martha. He literally says, like, you are worried about a great many things. Mary's chosen the better part. And here's what's wild. Jesus was about to get crucified. And he's just like sitting there. He's like, can we just chill for a minute? Rest. Relax. Calm. The Bible says labor to enter into the rest. What a phrase. Listen, Hebrews says this. Labor to enter into the rest. Rest takes work. Guys, the reason you can go to a psychologist and get mental work. You can go to a physical therapist and get physical work, but you got to come here tonight to get soul work. We got to do work on the soul. That's why I'm here. You got to do the work and labor. Like, peace is not just going to come to you from fairies. It's not just going to be like unicorns shooting rainbows out of their eyes, rainbow sandwiches and Pegasus steak for dinner. Like, you got to do the work. Labor. You got to labor to enter into the rest. This is something that the Bible says, you labor. It's interesting. I just found this out when I was reading Soren Kierkegaard the other day, one of my favorite existentialist philosophers who shaped Protestant Christian thinking in Christendom. This is what he said. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy, my burden's light. And what a lot of us do, and I've done this before, is we quote the end of the verse, where we say, Jesus has a burden that's light, his yoke is easy, he'll give you rest, but we don't quote the first part. We see the stipulation, the B clause, but the first part, this is what he says. He says, if you are weary and heavy laden, in other words, if you're exhausted out there, the world is beating you up, you've maybe been a workaholic, you're a stay-at-home mom and you have all these kids coloring on the walls or whatever it's like being a mom, I don't know. But you're so busy. Somebody said B-U-S-Y is an acronym, being under Satan's yoke. It's like just so busy. And the Lord's saying, if you've labored and you're carrying heavy burdens, then come to me and I'll give you rest. Did you know, this is nuts. When you read church history and you see these saints who woke up and prayed at 4 a.m., we're like, wow, that's really amazing. This is what we don't understand. That was pre-Enlightenment, pre-Industrial Revolution. Since the Industrial Revolution, with Edison and Tesla perfecting the light bulb, what happened is we don't go to bed when the sun sets anymore because we have electricity, which is just the controlling of the fluency of the currents of electrons. And so because we've harnessed the electron, we can now stay up as late as we want. So watch this. Nowadays, the average person gets 7 hours of sleep a night. Before the Industrial Revolution, back in the day, they averaged 10 to 11 hours of sleep per night. So when you're like, wow, that's so amazing, that saint would wake up at 4 a.m. to pray. It's not really that amazing if you went to bed at 6 p.m. It's so crazy. Richard Nixon had a subcommittee that predicted what life would be like in our generation, and the experts predicted that we would only work 20 hours per week because of the rise of technology. Robots would take care of this stuff. But what Nixon's subcommittee found, what they thought would be true in their projections, it's the polar opposite, diametrically opposed, contradistinction, binary, idea, and ideal. What's happened is we've actually got busier. We're exhausted. We're heavy laden.
These past few months, during my OptiMisfits book tour, I've got to speak around the world. And in all my speaking adventures, this is what I found. The nations are hungry for and being filled by the God of hope. Don't give up on our generation. We are in the presence. Enthusiasm for the God of hope is spreading. In fact, the word enthusiasm comes from the etymological roots en, in, theos, God. When you are in God, you can't help but be enthusiastic. Speaking before each crowd has confirmed in my heart that our generation will go down as the one that sought the face of God with passion. is falling on all flesh, people are getting excited while young men are seeing visions and old men are dreaming dreams and maidens are prophesying. And something tells me this is only the beginning.
We ran out of time today, but here's a quick clip of what you're gonna see in our next episode.
If you are wondering why there are no more C.S. Lewis's in the world, no more stories as good as Tolkien's, no cathedrals as great as the Gothic's, no music as moving as Pachelbel's, it may be because the writers of these books, the tellers of these stories, the architects of these buildings, and the composers of these symphonies are all sitting on their couches watching television.
We have about 500 intrusive thoughts per 16-hour day, each thought lasting about 14 seconds. That's why it's so important that we learn how to overcome anxiety and take our thoughts captive through neuroplasticity. So don't miss our next episode as we continue to talk about how we too can beat worry.
If God doesn't build the house, the builders only build shacks. If God doesn't guard the city, the night watchman might as well nap. It's useless to rise early and go to bed late and work your worried fingers to the bone. Don't you know he enjoys giving rest to those he loves? Psalm 127, verse 1 through 2. Being busy doesn't always mean being productive. If you're burnt out, I've got hope-filled news for you. God loves you and he wants to give rest to all who are weary and heavy laden. God's saying, partner with me in all that you do. I will renew your strength and sustain you, and I will be your unfailing source of inspiration and drive as you chase after the dreams, desires, and passions I've placed inside you.